Welcome to the Queer Spirit Podcast. I'm your host, Nick Venegoni. Here we have conversations with artists, healers, and activists who enliven the LGBTQ communities and who empower our queer spirits to flourish. My guest today is Ray Hippolyte. Ray is a relationship architect who supports single parents to out their inner awesome by becoming the one to find the one. We talk about how meditation can help you to show up more fully in your daily life and your relationships. Ray also shares with us the 3 steps to attract the perfect partner. Find out more about Ray and his work at outyourinnerawesome.com. Hi, Ray. Thank you for being here today. Welcome.
Thank you for having me here, Nick. How are you?
I'm good. So I wanted to start off by having you share a little bit about how you've said that your experience of getting divorced forced you to dive deeper into the realm of spirituality in ways that you never thought that you would. And I wonder if you can share more about that experience.
That's a very good question. What has helped me a lot to that process is adapting the mindset of every relationship as a divine purpose.
Hmm.
And having had that understanding that every relationship comes with a divine purpose to make us want to evolve, to become back to self, enabled me to approach this experience with a growth mindset, where I said, what am I here to learn from this experience? And instead of blaming the other person, I had to take full accountability for who I was being in the process to attract a situation that was quite devastating, I should say.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning, it was very difficult, but knowing that I played my role in it and really looking at the areas of my life that I needed to work on enabled me to start loving myself more, which required me to forgive myself. It was a constant process of forgiveness and surrendering, which gave me the emotional and spiritual muscles to do the same for my partner.
Mm-hmm.
Because love does not, only with love that you attract love. And diving into that shaming, blaming, vicious cycle would only fuel more resentment and would it truly help me improve who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And becoming a dad is even more important for me to want to evolve, to become a better dad. And let me tell you, it's amazing the growth that I've seen in me in 1 year. I'm a much better person out of that. So there's always a silver lining at the end of the tunnel.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So you talk about self-forgiveness. It sounded like you were implying that as a result of the divorce, maybe in the beginning, that there was self-blame that you had?
Of course. There was a lot of shame around, especially being a relationship coach. And I'm going through a divorce. I had shame around the whole notion of coaching around relationships.
Mm-hmm.
But what I've learned is, it's about how I recover. What makes you different than me and anybody else is our ability to choose skillfully in the now, knowing that we can create and express the unimaginable. And in order for us to be fully present in the now, we have to learn how to recover from our mistakes. And the fastest way to recover is to forgive yourself and to look at your innocence versus making you feel guilty for what you've done from a place of judgment.
Yeah, yeah. So I wonder if you could tell us a little bit more about your coaching practice and how you brought your experience of going through your divorce and being a single dad into that work.
My coaching practice, basically, I focus on helping people out their inner awesome so they can be the one in order to find the one.
Mm-hmm.
And when you define success, success is in direct proportion to your level of self-worth. And your self-worth is all about your self-concept, how you perceive yourself. Then how you perceive yourself is by social comparison and your cultural beliefs that you've acquired along the way. And your self-esteem, which is how you feel about yourself based on how you perceive yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And your self-confidence, which dive into the realm of how competent are you in different areas of your life. By helping people get out of their own way, by creating a practice of supporting beliefs to align with what they want, I help them have a good sense of self. Then I work on their self-esteem by releasing all of the negative experience from their past that tend to define who they are. But I make them release those stories by making them present to today. Because today in itself, that's where the magic lives. And the more we are stuck in a story, the more it prevents us from being here right now, able to speak our truth from a place of authenticity, knowing that you got to feel good. Otherwise, if you don't feel good, that means you're living in the past. Mm-hmm. You're stuck in the story. And that in itself is fun work. And how to get loved up is my little cliche by telling them, what are the rituals, the daily rituals that you're incorporating in your life day in and day out in order for you to strive for greatness? Because we are our practice. We are our habits. So what practice of thought, what practice of emotions that you have that getting you to the next level? And going back to your question about my experience with my divorce, I teach people really how to forgive themselves. Mm-hmm. And how to recover from difficult situations.
Yeah.
Because we're all caught up in that syndrome of looking good, which is all fear based on us being all afraid of what others think of us. But meanwhile, no one cares. Mm-hmm. What they truly care about is who you are, you being right now.
Mm-hmm.
And if your being is transformational in the now, they tend to forget what had happened in the past.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I think that the self-forgiveness and the self-acceptance pieces are really important. I notice that with a lot of the clients I work with. There's so much self-criticism and a harsh inner critic, and it really just stops them from being able to live their best lives and being so afraid of what other people think. Though yes, I really like that you emphasize that.
So true. But we're so domesticated to live from a place of extrinsic motivation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I can see from your website and your work that your connection with spirituality is a big part of your work. And you say that meditation is a central part of your life. And I wonder if you can say a little bit more about how that shows up in your life personally and how you bring that to your work.
That has been my favorite thing to do this past year.
Mm.
When I used to talk about meditation and my first exposure to meditation by learning the techniques of transcendental meditation,
because
I was so busy in that chatter, I needed to use techniques and tools that would enable me to slow down. And that's one technique where you just focus on a mantra and without having to truly quiet your mind, but the fact that you're not giving meaning to thoughts enables you to reach deeper level of consciousness. And if you truly want to download the infinite intelligence from the universe, you need to quiet the mind. If you really want to look at things from a fresh perspective, you need to quiet the mind. But what I've learned also in the process, what makes meditation even more beneficial to our well-being is through the practice of prayer. Because prayer is for by asking what you want from the universe, and meditation is to receive the download of what you want. And when you go through difficult situations in your life, it usually requires you to build some spiritual muscles.
Mm-hmm.
And once you build those spiritual muscles, there's a ripple effect on how it impacts your emotional muscle that helps you cope with those difficult situations by becoming more resilient, more resourceful.
Mm-hmm.
And so meditation right now, I do it twice a day, in the morning and in the afternoon. And it's amazing.
And what do you say to people who say, Ray, now how is meditation and prayer going to help me find the right partner?
Because what people do, they live in the future. Their future is their past. If they're looking at their current situation, right, as a reflection of what they want to manifest, they're going to repeat their past.
Mm-hmm.
So in order for them to get out of their own way, they have to stop that vicious cycle and really get to examine what are their true beliefs. And their true beliefs are not a reflection of their current reality. Their true beliefs lives in them, speak their truth. And that requires a quieting of the mind.
Yeah.
Don't you agree?
I do. I definitely agree. And this sort of makes me think about, you know, their inner beliefs and the way that they see the other world. And I'm thinking about one of the videos I saw on your Facebook page where you talked about throwing shade versus throwing light. And I noticed that there is a experience of people who may feel a little bit bitter or jaded about their experience of being single and use that to throw shade or judge other people instead of throwing light and positivity. And I can see how the meditation practice helps with that. And I wonder if you could share more about how you work with your clients around that kind of experience.
It's all about reframing the blame.
Say more about that.
What do? We project all of our fears into others. We project everything into others. But meanwhile, all of the emotions live in us.
Uh-huh.
The second that we start looking at emotion as data that are telling us, what is it in us that we need to look at and be ruthlessly compassionate toward? We start getting the real answers.
Mm-hmm.
And the second that we start identifying ourselves as love, which is the only truth that there is, as a light that lives inside the body, we start seeing the us in each other.
Mm-hmm.
We stop living in that delusion that we're all separate. We all come from a place of fear and love. We're all scared.
Mm-hmm.
We're all in this journey together to come back to self.
Yeah.
And if I start looking at you as the same person that has the same universal yearning as I am, which are to matter, to be seen, to love and to be loved, to self-actualize ourselves. And we put these things into practice daily and understanding that we are all fearful. So why don't we start by being compassionate toward one another? Then it will be a mad fast orgy of the souls. Uh-huh. Not the flesh.
Uh-huh.
The souls. Yeah. You will need the orgy of the flesh because all your needs will be fulfilled at a much higher vibrations.
Uh-huh. But the flesh isn't so bad either.
Oh, that is delicious. But imagine you combine both.
Oh, yeah.
Imagine.
That's the best.
Indeed.
You know, when I think about this, I think about the concept of fierce compassion, which comes from Buddhism, which I bring a lot of those ideas into my work with clients. And I'm hearing you say it's about having not only fierce compassion for other people, but fierce compassion for yourself too. So I wonder if you can share through your experience, what are some of the biggest struggles that some of your clients have had or people have with finding a good partner?
Their resistance to the whole concept of being real. People are fearful.
Mm-hmm.
And the second that they let go of fear, that's when they start really being in the court of their lives, which is the reason why I make people get into action on the first day that they start working with me.
Mm.
And what I mean by action is, what do we need to do today in order for you to start building the confidence that you need emotionally, spiritually, and mentally, and physically to get you to the next level? If you want love, where are you practicing being loving toward us? Is it on the internet? Are you going to be going on scruff and going to across the pond to a different country where you're going to minimize the risk? Because the bigger the risk, the bigger the fear of failure. And fear is the only emotion that is in the future. So by making them overcome the fear to being in action and harness it, that's when they start getting somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
But to get them there is a step-by-step process.
Mm-hmm.
Which makes it as painless as possible. But to really break the knot, it requires some work.
Mm-hmm.
What are your thoughts on that?
Well, what I'm hearing is that you have to put out what you want to receive.
Yes.
Right.
Be the one to find one.
Yeah, exactly. So I know that you have a three-step process to attract the perfect partner. And I wonder if you could maybe share with our listeners a little bit about what the first step is.
The first step is about getting out of your own way. and by creating a practice of supporting beliefs in line with the things that you want to attract. And we dive into getting very clear on what our beliefs are. And when you look at a belief, it should, for a belief to be your belief, it needs to fit three criteria. It should be grounded into solid facts. It should be justified and serve a useful purpose. And the third one, it should make you feel good. If it doesn't feel good, it's not your belief.
Mm-hmm.
But from that place, we start to identify what people's core values are. So many people do not know what their core values are because these are your rocks. The more you can create from a place of core values and understanding what you truly want and breaking it down into daily rituals, then you get somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So the first step is about getting very clear about what you want, not what others want, but what you want. What are you born to live and what do you want at your core?
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of self-reflection.
Yeah.
That's my favorite part of the work.
What are some of the common ways you see people getting in their own way?
By repeating the same things that they do over and over again and not realizing that they're the one that is a common denominator in all of those experiences.
Mm-hmm.
You know, blaming others is a very easy way to being a victim. Is a very easy way to be on your own way. Saying that I cannot do this is you getting in your own way. We have so many blind spots and we don't even realize that we're the one that playing small. That's my stand for humanity. My stand for every gay man. We are born here to teach the art of unconditional love.
Mm-hmm.
We truly are here to teach that because, and we do it intentionally and unintentionally. Just by being born, you're forced to ask your loved ones to start looking at you differently and love you differently. That in itself is causing their expansion.
Yeah.
You know? So if you truly own that truth, that's part of your journey here is to love yourself unconditionally and love others unconditionally. Wow, that entire process makes you want to reach your highest potential.
Absolutely. It's inspiring. So I wonder if you can share with us a person, practice, or experience that has supported your queer spirit to flourish.
I would say many of them, but the one that one of my biggest teachers have been HIV. And when I was diagnosed HIV, I literally wanted to kill myself because it was back then, there was a lot of stigma associated with HIV.
Mm-hmm.
And I never suffered physically from HIV. I suffered mentally from HIV. And that little boy that didn't feel that he was good enough, that little fat boy, shy boy, who attracted that, once and for all, wanted to start loving himself.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's so important for everyone to know that they're worth it. I think it's so important for everyone to know that they're good enough. We live in a world of scarcity. Everything that we want is already inside us. We are lovable.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine you start your day knowing that you're lovable. All your behaviors will start becoming accomplice of I am lovable. Anyway, I have a tendency of going on a tangent, but I'm so passionate about that topic. I really believe that everybody should feel worthy and lovable.
Yeah. No, I really appreciate you being vulnerable enough to share that with us. So thank you.
Oh, my pleasure.
Yeah. So how can people find you out in the world or online and find out more about your work?
They can look for me on my website, www.outyourinnerawesome.com, which is out, O-U-T, inner, I-N-N-E-R, awesome, A-W-E-S-O-M-E.com. Because we're all out here to out our inner awesome, to become the one, to find the one. And I look forward to having people come there and they can sign up to my email list and download my ebook, which are the 3-step process to find your irresistible partner.
Great. Well, thank you for sharing that with us. And thank you for being here today and talking with me. And thank you for all of your wisdom and inspiration.
Thank you. It was a pleasure and an honor. Bye, everyone.
Thanks for listening to the Queer Spirit Podcast. To find out more about all the resources we discussed today, find the show notes at thequeerspirit.com. You can also continue the conversation by joining the Queer Spirit Community Facebook group. Simply search Queer Spirit Community on Facebook. See you next time.